Sponsored by the Richard Weil Institute of Jewish Learning. We are really, really excited to have with us Rav Sobolovsky. Rav Tzvi Sobolovsky has been the Rosh Yeshiva at YU for, I guess, 20 years. Close enough. I didn't mention this to Rav Sobolovsky, but when I was, after my second year in Israel, I went to OJ, about 90,000-ish. I wanted to learn Hilchos Shabbos. I didn't know much. You know, you're a couple of years, you're trying to find yourself. I somehow got hold of the 5 CDs on Hilchos Special from Rabbi Sobolovsky. Okay, they're bootleg copies, so I apologize. I probably owe you a few dollars. But I've somehow obtained these 5 CDs on Hilchos Special, and from that point on, it transformed my understanding of Hilchos Shabbos in general, but Hilchos Special, and the clarity which Rav Sobolovsky is famous for was certainly present already. I guess that was a little over 20 years ago. So that was my first interaction with Rav Sobolovsky. And then it continued, because after my second year in Israel, I was back home in Los Angeles, where I grew up, and I got a phone call from some of my friends. So Rav Sobolovsky's brother-in-law, I didn't know at the time, Nati Samet, gives me a call and says, I know you guys like coming in the summer to play basketball at the Rubenstein's house, but we have a shiur beforehand. Rav Sobolovsky is giving a shiur. Why don't you come join us for the shiur? I said, Rav Sobolovsky, the one who I have the Hilchos Special CDs, I'm there. So I was there. I don't know if you remember me, but to be quite honest, there were a lot of, most of the guys were excelled far more than I did. Had Jacob Nyman and Josh Rubenstein, all these guys at Rosh Yeshiva, now in their own right. I was there. Things were clear, but you know, I still had a long way to go in terms of my growth as a Ben Torah. But that being said, I have been a Talmud, whether Rav Sobolovsky knows this or not. I've been a Talmud for over 20 years. So the fact that my Rebbe is able to be here and give us the honor of speaking and providing us with Devarei Torah is a great inspiration, personal inspiration, and a chizuk to me, and hopefully to the community as well. The topic for this evening's class is electricity, past, present, and the future. And I told Rav Sobolovsky before that everyone is hoping that Rav Sobolovsky will be able to give us a heter to use our Kindles on Shabbos. So just wait, bated breath to hear what the answer is going to be. And yeah, Rav Sobolovsky.
I have to give a disclaimer. If anybody's expecting a leniency on that one, so please finish your food and have a good night. Thank you so much for the kind words, B'shus Harav. I didn't realize that the introduction was really going to be a very real lead into how I was going to begin tonight's talk. It took me a little bit down memory lane. We just spoke about the last 20 years, but I'm going to go back a little bit further than that. Not in terms of our relationship, but a little bit further back in terms of history. Imagine for a moment if your great grandparents would walk into this room right now and would sit down. What do you think some of the things that would strike them would be? So I imagine the first thing they would really be scratching their head is, it's dark outside already. What is going on? Where did these things come from? not even going to begin to discuss some of the other devices that I see that are being used. They would have absolutely no clue what's going on. And the truth is, as we all know, the world has changed significantly, particularly in the realm of technology, not just in the last 100 years, but in the last 2 weeks. And the world just keeps on changing, constantly. I know my kids keep on making fun of me when they cannot even wrap around the concept that when I was their age, there were not that I didn't have a cell phone. There was no such thing as a cell phone. They still can't quite grasp that. Every once in a while, they ask me things like, you know, what are light bulbs? I try to catch them. But the thing we're trying to do a little bit is almost take us through history, but through the eyes of halacha, and to get a better understanding how the halacha interacts with this phenomena that has completely and totally changed the entire world. And that is, of course, not really the creation of electricity, but the growth of creating electricity has been in the world, but really the discovery of electricity and the invention of all the different devices that we have that revolve around electricity. And I want to try to study it a little bit from the past in the sense of how the early poskim addressed some of the issues that came up when electricity really hit the world scene, how some of the shilas have developed over the years, and maybe get a little bit of a glimpse into the future as to what some of the things, just not all that far away, some of the issues in halacha that we're going to have to challenge and have to deal with as electricity and technology continues to develop. So let's start really from the very basics, like everything starts. Everything starts back in the Chumash, back in the Torah itself. So when we speak about electricity, of course, most of what we're going to discuss is how electricity relates to Shabbos and beyond. There are other areas of halacha and electricity is also important there. But let's focus mostly today concerning Shabbos and Yom Tov. Where would we even begin to look? How do we even know how to deal with the question about electricity? Obviously, electricity wasn't being used in the Moshe Rabbeinu. So we have to go back to the source of the Chumash itself, where the Torah speaks about the prohibition against lighting a fire. Lo sivaru eish b'chol moshmoseichem b'yom haShabbos. The Torah tells us explicitly that one of the prohibited activities on Shabbos is one is not permitted to light a fire. What did lighting a fire mean in the olden days? Pretty much rubbing two sticks together, or if you already have a flame, throwing some more wood into the flame, you have a candle, adding some oil perhaps to the candle. That would have been a Torah violation of lo sivaru eish b'chol moshmoseichem. What is not permitted to light a flame, light a fire in any shape or form on Shabbos. It's interesting because there's a fascinating secondary interpretation of that pasuk. In addition to the simple reading, which is prohibition against kindling flames, you know, in the Sefer HaZohar, mystical side of Judaism, so the Sefer HaZohar tells us, "Lo sivaru eish b'chol moshmoseichem," refers to a prohibition against getting angry on Shabbos. Lo sivaru eish, when you get angry, you start to, you know, heat up a little bit. So it's not a good idea the other 6 days of the week either, but especially not on Shabbos. It's really fascinating because if you think about what is the tensest time, the most anxious time in an observant Jew's life, it's usually when the following conversations begin to take place. Now, in the wintertime, it takes place at about 4 o'clock, in the summertime, close to 3, which is always an amazing concept because it doesn't matter when Shabbos starts, no one's ever ready anyway. So the conversation goes something as follows. Did you get out of the shower already? Or did you bench left already? I'm 20 minutes late to Mincha. Those kinds of conversations begin to add a little bit of anxiety. And that's exactly what the Zohar tells us when Shabbos begins. So don't forget, the important part is this our age b'chol moshmoseichem. Not just don't turn on the light, not just don't light candles on Shabbos, but don't light up your own flame inside yourself. Calm, cool, collected is always the best way to enter the Shabbos. Not that I can say from personal experience I've succeeded at that, but at least it's a nice thing to spread to others. So the Torah tells us that we're not permitted to light fire in any shape or form on Shabbos. So the question is, what does that mean? So again, we know what traditionally what a fire meant. Now the question became, once a man by the name of Thomas Edison invented this notion called an electric light bulb, and the Shaila, the question that was posed to the Gedolei HaRabbanim, to the great poskim of Europe at the time, in the end of the 1800s, was, is the turning on of an electric light a halachic equivalent of lighting of a fire? But maybe it's different. And the consensus view of all the great Gedolim, the great sages in Europe, again, in the end of the 1800s, was that the two are equivalent to one another, that the turning on of an incandescent bulb is considered to be halachically the equivalent of lighting a fire. It actually has its sources in the Talmud, and some of the early authorities in the Talmud, where discussion is had about what's called the Achela Shama Teches. Teches meaning metal, and almost like a coal of metal. And according to the way the Rambam presents the halacha and Rashi and other great Rishonim, other great early authorities, describe that the lighting or the making warm, glowing of a piece of metal is halachically the same as the actual lighting of a flame. And therefore, if you think about it, an old style light bulb for sure is simply that. A piece of metal, a piece of copper, whatever it is, a piece of metal filament inside that is heated up and it starts to glow, and that is the halakha equivalent of lighting a flame. So this was the consensus view, and this was the accepted view of halakha. This was accepted to such an extent that some of the great sages, already in the beginning of the early 1900s, wanted just to make sure that everybody understood this. Everybody got this clear. Nobody should argue, nobody should question, well, maybe, Rabbi, you can turn on the light on Shabbos. Maybe it's not so bad. It's not really like striking a match. So there were actually some of the great Rabbanim who, on Motzoi Shabbos, when Shabbos was over, as part of Abdullah, they would go out of their way to recite the bracha of Borei Ma'ore Ha'esh on an electric light bulb to show everybody that they shouldn't think that, oh, this is not real, this is not really fine. You can do this on Shabbos also. No. Borei Ma'ore Ha'esh, this is Ha'esh, this is the real Makor. There was actually a question, a conceptual question, a Lomdish question that was raised. Is this really true? Is this equation actually true? Because if you think about it, there is a big difference between the, let's say, the lighting of a candle, oil, or the putting of wood into a flame, and an electric light bulb. One of the big differences that some poskim raised was that in the case of the oil, or the case of the wood, so not only is it providing a glow and providing heat, providing light, but the item is actually getting consumed in a very visual way. We could see that when you put oil into a candle, after a short amount of time, so the oil is gone. Well, let's say a person presses the gas on his car, so after a little bit of time, the gas is going to be done. That's why you have to go back to the gas station next time to fill up. So it's clear that something is being consumed. When one turns on an electric bulb, one could argue that it's not clear to the eye that something is actually really happening. Nothing's really being consumed. Is that an important factor or not? So one of the most fascinating proofs, so to speak, was that we actually have a precedent in the Chumash itself for a fire, something that the Torah considers to be a fire that was not consumed. Anyone remember what was the most famous fire that wasn't consumed? The sneh, the burning bush. So there's actually some poskim wanted a real proof. The neha sneh bo'er bo'eish. I guess that was the first incandescent bulb. That there was nothing was happening, it was burning, it was glowing, it was light and heat, and it was still considered to be an ancient halacha. Again, whether one thinks that is an ironclad proof or not, whether it's probably arguing with that proof, but the halacha, this was clearly accepted view, and this is of course the view that has prevailed until this very day, that the turning on of an electric light is considered to be a Torah prohibition. However, since we're getting a little bit closer to Yom Tov also, Shavuos is almost around the corner, a while from now, so let's raise the following question. True, just because one cannot turn on an electric light on Shabbos, does that automatically mean that the same is true for Yom Tov? Now, Yom Tov and Shabbos are similar but not identical. We know that there are certain things one is permitted to do on Yom Tov. For example, one is allowed to, and I'm going to be very careful I say this, to light a flame on Yom Tov. Yes, you're permitted to light a candle on Yom Tov, provided that you don't start the fire from scratch. What one is not allowed to do on Yom Tov is to strike a match. What is not allowed in the olden days, rub two sticks together. The Mishnah tells us in the second Beitza that that is a prohibition on Yom Tov. But if the flame is already there, then one can add to that flame, and that's perfectly right. We know we do that all the time, but we light candles, Yom Tov candles, especially on the second night. Well, I want to say this year Shavuos is going to be on Motzei Shabbos, is the first night of Yom Tov. So obviously we're not going to light the candles on Shabbos. We're going to wait till Shabbos is over, and then we light candles on Yom Tov. But where are we lighting those candles from? The answer is we're not striking a match. We're going to be using it from a pre-existing flame. So this is clearly accepted halacha. The question becomes: is turning on an electric light a halachic equivalent of starting a fire from scratch? Or is it turning on an electric light the equivalent of just adding to a pre-existing flame? Where is a pre-existing flame? Well, that's kind of hard to understand, and it probably doesn't exist. So although there were some opinions, true, in Europe, there were some gedolim of the poskim, who perhaps were of the opinion that one could actually turn on an electric light on Yom Tov, because they viewed the turning on of the electric light as an extension, almost like a pre-existing, there's already something there. The overwhelming majority of the poskim did not follow that. And today, that practice is pretty much not accepted. There was a practice, I do this, although I remember as a child, there were families that were very completely Torah observant, Shomer Shabbos, Yom Tov, and had the practice of turning on lights on Yom Tov. So that there were great rabbanim who sanction that practice. Over the years, that has become really the minority view. I don't know, maybe there are still people who do it, but that's not considered to be the majority view today. So we assume that the turning on of a light of night and yom tov would be problematic, would be a prohibition based on the idea that it's the equivalent, closer to the model of starting something from scratch rather than just extending it reasonably. But it's actually for this reason that this has caused a lot of complications in terms of cooking on yom tov. In the good old days, when I was a kid, not all that long ago, cooking on yom tov was very simple. Not that I didn't cook on yom tov, but it was easy for my mother to cook on yom tov. You just simply turned on your stove. Why did you turn on your stove? Because there was a pilot there. And since there was a pilot already there, when you turn on a gas stove, you're just adding a little more gas into the flame, and that's perfectly permissible on yom tov. The problem is today, most of our stoves don't work that way. They work with ignitions, with electric starters. And therefore, when you turn on the stove, so you are, in effect, doing something electric, which poses a problem. Some of you may be familiar, there are all kinds of different kunsim, different things that have been developed today, Shabbos modes, and Yom Tov modes, and ovens, and everything. I'll tell you a story about one of the Yom Tov modes. There's no question, again, it's not the topic for tonight, but there are different opinions about using some of these modes, switching this temperature, etc., on Yom Tov. And a couple of years ago, actually, before Shavuot, so I spoke about it in my shul, and I recommend that people not adjust the flame, whatever, leaving out the details. Right now, again, there are different opinions about that. So I gave a big push. People should just leave the flame or whatever it is, and not further adjust it, even with the specific modes in place. So my luck, so we had trouble with our stove all of a sudden. That smell of that stove gas, that wonderful smell, you know you have trouble, so you have to quickly get the gas company in, the Kuf Mefesh, dangerous situation. So we had our PSCNG, I don't know if they have that. They made it all the way down the Grand State with me. Okay, so the PSCNG fella comes, fella comes in, and he's looking at the stove, and he says, "What's that thing in the window that says salve on it? What does salve mean? It's the Shabbos mode, it says on the display. What's salve?" I said, "Oh, that's the Sabbath mode." He says, "What is that?" Well, it's a very lumbish child. He said, "I've been working for PSG for 50 years. I never saw any of these things." I don't want to say, I don't want to be disrespectful, but if you would walk down the block, every single house. So I felt that it was kind of the Shabbos mode getting its revenge on me because I had given shit the day before not to use it, so I ended up having to do it. Okay, but anyway, getting back to that story. So in terms of Shabbos, we turn on the regular electric lights out of the question. Again, according to most opinions today, that would have to be a serious problem. But what are we dealing with, a type of a electric device that doesn't involve lights per se, doesn't involve a quote-unquote halachic flame? I want to turn on, just for argument's sake, a vacuum cleaner. I want to turn on a fan. I want to turn on something that doesn't have a light connected to it. What would that halacha be about that? It would be hard to call that lo sabah rupesh v'chomosh v'secha anymore. That's not really a flame. So what's the problem? So why should that be problematic? So there's actually a major dispute between the poskim as to why that should be a problem. We assume halacha, that's off limits. You can't have any electric device whatsoever, either Shabbos or Yom Tov. But why exactly it is prohibited if it's not part of the prohibition of lighting a flame is a little bit more questionable. There was a view of the Chazon Ish, which is one of the great poskim originally from Europe and many years in Eretz Yisrael. The Chazon Ish was of the opinion that any and every kind of electric device is an actual Torah prohibition. It's considered to be one of the 39 categories of prohibited work on Shabbos, and the category that the Chazon Ish described it was falling under is rather startling. The Chazon Ish said that it falls under the category of what's called bona. Bona literally means to build. So if you have the imagery of building, you kind of think of like some kind of construction team, you know, coming out there with a hard hat, building a house for you, that's all, that is bona. But there's another much more subtle kind of bona. The Gemara speaks about a person who makes a kli. Literally, you take a couple of pieces together. The Gemara actually talks about a person who takes a piece of metal, takes a piece of wood, and puts the two pieces together and makes a shovel. The Gemara quotes one opinion that says that's bona. You were bona kli. You just made a utensil. As you said, that's exactly what you just did. You took a piece of junk. You took a vacuum cleaner that can't do anything. Don't try to vacuum the floor when it's off. Go try to use a fan when it's not plugged in. It's not going to work. You plugged it in, you turned it on, and you just did a chias amesim. You just brought it to life. You took a piece of metal, a piece of junk, and you turned it into a functioning clay. Argue the Chazon Ish, that's considered to be a Torah prohibition of bona. So not everybody agreed to the condemnation, and that's a big point. There were others who claimed that, of course, you cannot turn on the fan and cannot do the diagram. They weren't arguing about the facts, but they were arguing about the facts and the lumpness of the analysis of the condemnation. Some wanted to claim that that's not really considered to be bonehead. They actually gave an interesting mushroom, interesting example. Said if a person builds a wall, clearly that is a prohibition bonehead. No question, that's open to building. You take cement, you take the wood, you take something, you build a wall, build a structure, that's bonehead. However, what is not bonehead is the opening and closing of the door. Very lumpish question. Why is it closing the door? Bonehead, I just close up all this. Yes, that's not cool. Building, that's called using. That's called the usage of a door. So others wanted to argue that when I'm using the vacuum cleaner, I'm not building, I'm not in the vacuum cleaner business, I'm not manufacturing a fan, I'm simply using a fan, and that by definition cannot be voted. So if it's not voted, what is it then? So there are many who argue that the reason why these things, or all kinds of other electrical appliances are off limits, is it falls under the category of what's called molid. Molid is a rabbinic prohibition, not a Torah prohibition, but still prohibited nonetheless. A rabbinic prohibition of, almost in a sense, creating new kinds of things. The Gemara actually talks about if a person takes ice and starts crushing up the ice in order to make water on Shabbos, so that's called molid, because you're creating something new. Now, I know I'm in my 10th grade chemistry, it's all the same thing, it's all H2O, whether it's in the solid state, liquid state, yes, I got that, I remember that also. But nevertheless, the halacha views it as you're almost like doing something new. You're creating something from scratch, and that poses a problem. So there are many folks who are of the opinion that all electric devices, even those that don't involve lights, are clearly prohibited, but perhaps the prohibition would be a less than the degree prohibition, would be a prohibition with the rabbinic nature rather than actual Torah prohibition. Practically speaking, Baruch Hashem was speaking to an observant crowd, we're talking about the Shomri Torah mitzvahs. So what's the difference? At the end of the day, Rabbi, whether you tell me something is prohibited according to the actual Torah itself, or whether you tell me that something was part of a later rabbinic prohibition, at the end of the day, I'm not allowed to do it. At the end of the day, if I do it, that's fair to Shabbos. So does it really make much of a difference practically for me whether the Chazanish is right, whether others are right? So the answer is for you, it probably doesn't make a difference, but it would make a difference in the following sense. If not you want to do something, but you want to ask a non-Jew to do something on your behalf. Now, there's a general rule in halacha that what I'm not allowed to do, I'm not supposed to ask a non-Jew to do as well. That's what's called in halacha amir al-akhla, real and nachr. Asking a non-Jew is also it's a little bit of a misunderstood halacha. There is that notion, some people grew up with this notion called the Shabbos goy. That's not the nicest term, but it's probably not even correct, the halachic, accurate term. So the starting point is that you're not supposed to ask non-Jews to do things. There are certain communities, certain extenuating circumstances, cases of illness, cases of other kinds of quasi-emergencies, even though not literally emergencies. There are certain cases where a little bit more lenient with asking non-Jews to do things. One of the basic rules in asking non-Jews to do things is the following important principle, that if the action involved is only rabbinic in nature, and I'm asking the non-Jew to do it, and there's a big mokum mitzvah, there's a real need, it's a very, very significant need that I have. If I have three factors all pointing in the same direction, all in my favor. I'm asking the non-Jew to do something that's only rabbinic, I'm not doing it myself, it's not a Torah prohibition, and there's a mitzvah involved, so then it would in fact become permissible. And that becomes very important for us practically speaking. Many, many shuls have this challenge, homes have this challenge. You're walking to shul, and somebody, I don't want to point fingers, but somebody didn't point, no, tonight, nice and comfortable here, it was okay. Sometimes you walk the shul and the air conditioning is not set properly. And they thought it was going to be 40 degrees outside and it's 90 degrees outside. And you're collapsing. Or sometimes the other way around. Sometimes the heat isn't working. So you have these kinds of scenarios. Or sometimes the lights weren't set properly. You have a lot of things that can go wrong in shul setting, in private settings. And the question is, obviously, we're not going to do these things ourselves. Do we have the right to ask non-Jews to do certain things on our behalf? So the answer to that question is, it depends. If we're dealing with something which is a real bona fide Torah prohibition, that becomes much more difficult to sanction. Very, very extenuating circumstances could mean that also, but that becomes much more difficult. However, if we're dealing with something which is only rabbinic in nature, such as, for example, according to many opinions, turning on the air conditioning, the fans, those kinds of things, if those things are only rabbinic in nature, and there's a big makom mitzvah, not exactly the makom mitzvah is. No one's going to be able to daven it, it's 90 degrees inside, and everyone's kind of sweating. So that's going to interfere with our ability to do mitzvahs properly. for them, there would be certain grounds that they would be holding. I don't want to postulate a shayla in somebody else's shul, but these are some of the things that, you know, start going through the rabbi's mind when these shaylas come up. You have to first, you know, ask yourselves, is this a Torah prohibition? Is this a rabbinic prohibition? Is it a mokum mitzvah? Is it not a mokum mitzvah? And these are a lot of the things that go into our discussion. So not all electric devices are necessarily the same. Lights are, as I mentioned before, the most serious of all. But without lights, a little bit more lenient. And again, each one would have to be analyzed by itself and on its own merits. So up to now, we've been talking about, I would say, we've been at the end of the 19th century. We made a way, probably got halfway through the 20th century or so. None of the things, none of the grandiose devices that I've mentioned from anything that has been found and been invented the last couple of years. And now we start to move forward a little bit. And we start to run into some interesting shilas, some things that may impact on the future. But before we get to the literal future, let's just catch ourselves up a little bit more close to contemporary issues. And that is, in the only way to get anything done was to press a button, turn a switch or something. And now, I don't even mean even now, 2019, but recently there are a lot of other ways to get things to be done. Namely, you could just walk past something. And when you walk past something, all kind of funny things start happening. Lights start going on, sounds start happening, clicks start happening, videos start taking a view, a million different things. I don't know anything. I just walk around from shul, minding my own business, and next thing I know, I turned on 40 lights along the way. That is the halacha. Is that the equivalent of I turned on lights at Shabbos, and that's not such a good thing to do? Or do we have a right to say, I didn't turn on, I'm walking around from shul. The lights up. Who turned it on? It was a miracle. The light didn't have any sound. So this shayla became very, very prevalent. That's, I don't know, 30 years ago, so to give or take, when all of a sudden, many of you go, there are motion detectors. And the question becomes, how does halacha view this? So, as we've seen already in the case of electricity, you have to go back to the sources. Everything has to have its roots back to the Torah itself, to the Parashat Vayetzev, to the Oral, to the Mishnah, to the Gemara, to the early authorities, Shulchan Aruch, and try to figure out how would we even apply this kind of idea. So the Gemara actually tells us the following in a very, very important discussion about what if I do something on Shabbos that per se is permissible. I'm allowed to do action A, but there is a chance that action B may happen. And if the bad luck in action B occurs, that is a problem. That is a halakhic problem. That is a malacha. That is a prohibition on Shabbos. But on the other hand, I'm not particularly interested in doing B. And quite frankly, I'm not even sure B is going to happen. So we'll give an example, a very simple example, actually an example that the Gemara itself gives. I want to drag a chair in my backyard on Shabbos. There is nothing wrong with dragging a chair on Shabbos. Problem is, if I drag it over dirt, I may make a hole. And digging a hole on Shabbos is a big problem. But now I want to know, Rabbi, can I drag the chair? So the answer is actually, it's a dispute in the Gemara itself, and the answer is yes. That it is permissible for me to drag that chair, even though there is a good chance, 50-50 chance, that a hole may be made, that's okay. I'm not interested in the hole, I wasn't planning on the hole, I didn't know the hole was going to happen. That's what's called in halacha, a dover she'enu miskaven, and that would be permissible. However, the Gemara tells us the buck stops here. What if it's not a 50-50 chance? What if it's what is called a psik ratio? Means I know for a fact it's going to happen. Not a question, maybe it'll make a hole. I'm carrying this huge couch, for sure it's going to make a hole. That's called the psik ratio. It's a very strange term, psik ratio. It doesn't have the most prettiest connotation, but basically it's named after a chicken. And the Gemara says that a person has no right to say, well, I just cut the head off the chicken. I wasn't planning on the chicken dying. That's intoxicational. And almost chopped off the head of the chicken. Fool, you think the chicken's not going to die? So if you jam your schlep, a quasi, a little folding chair in the backyard, maybe yeah, maybe no, so that we can permit. You get a schlep, a whole heavy sofa, and think, well, nothing's going to happen. Of course something's going to happen, and that's a problem. So psychoration becomes problematic in halacha. Then there's a further breakdown within that category of psychoration. What if I'm very happy with the result, and what if I'm not so happy with the result? So I'll draw you two different illustrations. I want to wash the tefillah shadayim. I'm about to eat my meal, and I want to wash my hands with the shadayim in my backyard. So there's nothing wrong with washing your hands in Shabbos. The problem is, in your backyard, you're washing over the grass, and when you pour water over the grass, that grass is going to grow. So the question is, that's the problem, not let it cause the grass to grow on Shabbos. So there may actually be a difference. Is it your backyard? Is it somebody else's backyard? If it's your backyard, then you are very interested in that grass growing. If it's somebody else's backyard, unless you're a nice guy, you paid his gardener bills also, you probably couldn't care less about that. So So there are differences and details and gradations in halacha, depending on how much I want the result to happen, how much I don't want, how much I don't care about it. Again, it gets a little bit difficult in terms of every single detail, but we have kind of streamlined the sugya a little bit. But much of this is up for discussion when the poskim deal with these issues. A person walks past a sensor. Do you care about that sensor? Does it interest you that you're now being videoed and you're being shown on 4,000 security cameras throughout the entire world? It probably does interest you. There's only one person you want the security guy on camera, that's the guy you don't want on the show. So otherwise, it doesn't bother you with your security guy on camera. But when I walk past the sensor and a light shows on, am I happy with that or not? Well, it depends. It depends how dark it is. If the light goes off in the middle of the afternoon, I probably couldn't care less about it. However, if it's pitch black outside, I'm about to fall, and now, oh, Baruch Hashem, I didn't mean that because the Shabbos, but off the record, it kind of happened, the light went on, so that would be a problem. Remember, somebody asked me a Shiloh, they called me about 3 minutes before Shabbos. I love those Shilohs, always the best. So they called me 3 minutes before Shabbos, but they realized when they're staying in a place, the only way for them to get downstairs is to walk down the stairs, and every time you open up the door, so all the lights go on. I said, are any of the lights from anywhere else? So maybe we could argue, you don't get light. Pitch black, they're going to trip down 40 flights of stairs. So I said, well, you can walk really slow. Close your eyes. It doesn't matter when the lights are on. They weren't happy. They said, well, you can always stay home for Shabbos. So it wasn't, the conversation didn't go over very well. So the bottom line is, you learn a few things from here. Number one, the most important thing is plan in advance. Don't end up 2 minutes before Shabbos in a place realizing that the lights are going on. But we do sometimes end up in these places. Sometimes it doesn't end up in hospital settings, other settings that we weren't planning on. So the basic rule of the poskim is that if one really doesn't care about it, very often one doesn't. Most of these things you don't really care about. If you're really stuck, so then, strictly speaking, most of these things will be permissible based on the situation, the nichle, I'm not too excited about the results, etc. But again, these are issues that the poskim have discussed and continue to discuss as technology, electricity, as things have become a little more advanced. So the old child is back in the time of sensing days, just pressing a button, have a long gone. Now we're walking past sensors and turning on lights. But of course, this was like last century already. We're well into the 21st century. And of course, we know that you don't even have to do anything today. All you have to do is just open up your mouth and say a word. And if I were to come back about 20 years from now, you probably won't even have to do that. You just have to do this. And how old lights are going to go. So the ready reflexive will let you read your mind by as we speak, if I come over that. But right now, all you have to do is walk into the room and say, Alexa, turn on my light, turn on my TV, turn on my this, turn on my that. Wait a second, hold the phone, 1 second. On Shabbos, what is going on? Can one? I came to somebody's house. It was on Shabbos, the weekday. I came to someone's house, and it was actually it was on Purim, and they were trying to get the Purim music on. And they were talking and screaming at this. Oh, poor Alexa, I felt so bad for this. The Purim song! And I could start to play the Hanukkah song. The Purim song! Did you say the family song? And it was not a very good conversation. But and so we got a person to get their act together, and Alexa actually understands what you're talking about. So what is that lacha? Can one use that on Shabbos? So it would appear that the answer is absolutely not, based on a few different reasons. One reason actually is related to something that we spoke about before, about the prohibition of asking non-Jews to do things for you. Why is it that I can't ask a non-Jew to do something for me in Shabbos? What's wrong with that? Well, there are actually many, many reasons that are given for this prohibition. One of the prohibitions is linked to a series of psukim in the Navi, the prophet Yeshayahu, where the Navi tells us that on Shabbos it is important not just not to do actions out of the lava, but even the way one speaks on Shabbos has to be different. It's called Taber Dovah. One is not permitted to even speak about doing work on Shabbos. That's one of the reasons why I can't ask a non-Jew to do work for me. But by doing so, I'm speaking about halacha. Actually, the halacha tells us that you're not even supposed to speak about work by yourself. It's, I'm not even asking anyone to do it. I'm telling you a story. Shabbos afternoon, I'm sitting around at the lunch table, I'm saying, guess what? After Shabbos, I'm driving to the mall. So that's a problem. Believe it or not, even though I didn't do anything, just the fact that I said I'm driving somewhere, that's a problem. The folks keep saying what you can say is, I'm going somewhere. Now, probably shouldn't say I'm going to the mall, because that's a little not Shabbos. I am going somewhere. So that would technically be okay, because you didn't mention malacha. I could theoretically walk there, be a very, very long walk. I am going to California at the Shabbos. It's a long walk, but you could do it. So technically speaking, you could. Remember, back about five more than 20 years ago, I used to teach a Shabbos shiur in Stern College, and I was teaching this halacha. We were discussing with the women this particular halacha that I want you to be careful when you speak on Shabbos about going places, try to leave the word driving out of the picture. Try to focus on the word going rather than driving. So one of the young ladies in the class came back the following week to tell me, and she went home and informed our parents of what she had learned. That's always thrilling when parents find out what they're actually spending their tuition money for. And every time the conversation went about our parents saying they were driving somewhere, she kept on just kind of, you know, come on, Abba, come on, Rem, let's all do it together. No driving, we are going, not driving, remember? And this young lady said to me, it reached a point where her mother said to her, that you are driving me crazy. I am so sorry. So when a person speaks to Alexa, I don't think that's any worse than any better than speaking to an Andrew, not to speak to yourself. So I think that would be a problem. But I suspect that there may be something even more problematic. It may actually be an even more serious Torah prohibition of using these kinds of devices at Shabbat based on the following. The Gemara has a discussion about the area of Allah that seems to be very, very far away from what the Shabbos. But one of the beauties of the Torah Shabbat, the Talmud, and the halakhic process is that if you look around at what we call a fochba, bafochba, the kulubba, you turn everything upside down enough times, you'll find the right answer. You find the wrong answer, but hopefully you try to find the right answer. So if you look sometimes in an area of halacha that's very, very far from the particular area that you're interested in, you can actually find it inside. So there is a discussion in the Gemara, in Masechet Bava Metzia, which has nothing to do with Hilchos Shabbos. It's dealing with the intricacies of a person muzzling their animal. Probably most of you haven't had those particular shahs. I don't know if you've shahs. You're very interested in burning them, not too many of them. But the Torah says you're not allowed to muzzle your animal when it's working. The Gemara raises the question, what if a person doesn't actually literally take a muzzle, but they use their mouth to muzzle? Namely, every time the poor animal goes to eat, well, hey, get away from it, stop screaming and yelling at the animal. The Gemara says that's a problem. The Gemara says that's a violation of muzzling an animal. That's no different between that and literally physically muzzling the animal. Why is that? So the Gemara discusses what's called about a person's mouth. The words that come out of a person's mouth, when I say something and my words result in an action taking place, so that is considered to be an extension of me. As if no difference in the eyes of halacha than if somebody literally did it with their own hands. So according to that, it would appear to me that if a person utters a word, says Alexa, turn on the light, and Alexa responds and turns on the light, so halakhically, you turned on the light. That is the equivalent of your doing maisa of turning on the light. So we started off the shiur by saying turning on the light is not a good thing on Shabbos. Though sabar eish b'chomosh l'seichem, that may be a real bona fide Torah prohibition. So I know that some people are expecting some kulas, but that particular kula is going to be hard for me to describe. So it would appear that the halacha is that not only can one not turn on the lights themselves, one cannot walk past the lights in a way you really, really like, and you're planning for the lights to go on, that would also be a problem. And for sure, if a person is, in a sense, actively, verbally commanding the lights to go on, that would pose a problem as well. So we did get a little bit of a sense, you know, just a little smattering of how the halacha, in a sense, is able to respond. One of the greatest, you mentioned before, the halakhic process, is the ability for the Torah, for Allah, to be able to respond as new things show up. So we're not nervous, not worried about what new shahs are going to come up in the future. We'll figure out, we'll be able to try to apply the principles properly. I thought we'd just end just a little bit to get perhaps even a greater appreciation of the notion of Torah in the sense of the eternity of Torah. As we're in the days of Sfiras Omer, we're getting a little closer and closer to Kabbalah Satorah. So it's always important for us to take a little bit of a step back and really to appreciate just really what we have today. You know, I started out by saying that if your great-great-great-grandfather walked into the room, he would probably be blown away. He really wouldn't know what to do in terms of lights and microphones and videos and all kind of stuff. He wouldn't know. And then you would try to strike up a conversation with him or her, and you would probably have very little to talk about. I mean, you would, you know, you kind of like ask them, well, how was your day today? So they would say, well, I moved my cow in the morning, and you know, hopefully we survived another day. And they would ask, what did you do today? Well, you know, I flew to Chicago for a business meeting today. Well, you know, it would be a very difficult conversation because we do live in such fundamentally different worlds. And then imagine for a moment, you start to strike up a conversation and ask them, how was Shabbos? How was Shabbos? It was great. I made kiddush. I made a motzi. I ate shulam. I took a nap. I went to the avenue, I heard later. Wait a second, I did the same thing. Okay, it's true. That's true. He was in a little hole, you know, a little shtetl somewhere in Poland, you know, with some candles. I got it, okay. And we're a little bit, we've changed a little bit. Essence doesn't change. And imagine if you try to strike up a conversation about current events, you wouldn't know what to talk about. You wouldn't have a common language. And then you would start to talk about a Torah, current event. And you start to talk about something about the parsha. It's the same parsha. And then you maybe want to go a little bit step further. Let's learn a Mishnah together. I'd have no problems. I can open up a Gemara together. We would have no problems. And guess what? You could discuss Torah, not just with your great-great-great-great-grandparent. You could discuss Torah with the Rambam, or with Rashi, or with Rabbi Akiva, mm-hmm. or with Moshe Rabbeinu for that matter. And you would have a common language. You would have something to do that. There's a beautiful piece of Torah Salvation that he describes about when he walked into the Shir room, and he was ready over the time. He says he was speaking to these young kids in their early 20s, and he always got a little bit, he was inhibited. He said, how are they going to understand me? What do we have in common? We have nothing to talk about. And then he realized that all separation, all distinctions, everything fades to the wayside because Torah is ultimately unifying force. There's a really a tremendous word of inspiration that somebody pointed out. It's now 2019, so somebody pointed out 19 years ago. It was on January 1st of 2000, the year that, so you remember, when we went to the, it was actually a Friday night, it was a Shabbos, and the clock struck the night, and we were all geared up to assume that we were going to sleep, and that the world was going to like self-destruct, because no one really knew what it was called, the Y2K, it was like something that I can't even remember it anymore. Like we had this kind of like script, where people like in underground, like shelters, like waiting for something to happen, and then, all I remember is I was stressed asleep, but I was somebody was like a couple of firecrackers, they were all sort of screaming about it. But if I'm not mistaken, it was the New York Times that ran an interesting edition that next day, and they came up with a tremendous thought. They wanted to see what will the world look like in 100 years from now. So let's make believe we're going to run the newspaper for January 1st, 2100. What's it going to look like? And they had a big problem, because you have to be enough, if you're a prophet, how in the world are you going to know what's going to be 100 years now? What are you going to write about? This country can't get, how do you know what's coming? You know, who knows what's the world's going to be like? You can write the sports page. How do you know that which teams are going to be around? I know what sports are going to be around. Maybe baseball. I don't know. I don't know who else is going to be 100 years from now. And they really, really had a challenge. And there was one thing that they put on the front page, which was probably the most profound message that speaks to the heart each and every day. On Friday, in the New York Times, there's a little corner, a little tiny little ad that says, you know, candlelighting time is such and such. They put that on the corner of 2100, the January 1st, 2100, and the word for the editor apparently was that we have absolutely no idea what the world's going to look like in 100 years, but we know that there will be Jewish women lighting candles in 100 years from now. And that is true. And really, if you think about it, that's ultimately what we're celebrating, and that's what we're commemorating when we get close to the Shavuos. We're celebrating the eternity of the Torah, which is also restoring the eternity of the Jewish people. So we gave a little bit of a glimpse today, tonight, of just how eternal the Torah is, that the same Torah can address the candles and the wax of our great-great-grandparents, the shtetls, that the same Torah can address the incandescent bulbs of 100 years ago, the same Torah can talk about the all the videos, all the mind, everything that's happening, all the senses that we're passing day in and day out, and the same Torah can look to the future, talk to Alexa, and who knows what's around the corner. It's the same Torah. Baruch Hu is eternal, the Torah is eternal, the Jews are eternal. Hopefully, this gives a little bit of appreciation, get a little bit closer to Tzman HaTorah Seinu, to appreciate and understand, and thank the Shabbat for the beautiful business.
All right.
I have a question. You have a refrigerator, you shut the lights off on the refrigerator, you put water in the freezer. Can you use that water?
So that is the question about whether the making of water, the ice itself, is a problem. It actually touched on what we mentioned before. Does it change the state of something? The Gemara speaks about going from ice to water, so that may be a problem. So some of the opinion that going from water to ice is also a problem. And not everyone agrees. There are actually two different opinions about that very question. It's a very, very good question. Very, very excellent.
If you're allowed to ask a non-Jew to turn on the AC on Shabbos, you ask Alexa.
I think that Alexa is more problematic. I think it's more problematic because since it's being done at your command, so it's really an extension. I'm treating it as a separate entity, a separate person. So So that's a really after, that would be a drabana that's permissible from the mitzvah, etc. Doing the self-thing would be much more
problematic. But it's from the same...
No, but I think it's even more. That's what I mentioned, that there are actually two reasons why Alex is problematic. It's problematic because of Dabra Dabra, and yes, in that truth, it's even worse, because since it is directly resulting from your command, as a given itself.
Which you can say now.
I heard with interest when you were talking about the SAV on the like the Shabbos mode, right? Are there different opinions on this? Because I have two sons of law who are YU graduates who don't use this. So I'm just wondering if there are different opinions.
So there are different opinions about when the Sabbath mode is on, it accomplishes a few things with Sabbath mode. But one of the things that someone did is actually to raise the temperature while on the Sabbath mode. And there were some who didn't approve of it. They felt that there were still things that were happening even in Sabbath mode that would potentially be bad.
What about, so it's 90 degrees, and the Shabbos goy is standing there and says, it's awfully hot in here. He takes the hint and he turns the air conditioning down. I mean, it's not, you're not telling him to do it.
Hinting is always a little bit tricky. There are actually different kinds of hinting. There are sometimes hinting which are direct, or the commanding hinting, and then there are hinting where I just kind of walk and make a statement. And make this this very, very, neutral statement. It happens to be 115 degrees in here. Pretty hot there. So, sometimes we find ourselves in situations where there's a language barrier.
Yeah.
So sometimes I can be saying whatever.
What does Shabbos guy know? That when it comes to a certain temperature, he can turn it up or turn it down. Without him saying it, this is kind of his contract.
Right. So that would make matters, in situations of shul, we're a little bit more lenient because tzorchei rabin, because there it affects a lot of people. So the halacha that takes that into consideration. So many shuls have that kind of system where they have, especially concerning air conditioning, things like that. Air conditioning also is a concern. If it gets very hot, some people can actually get sick. Overheat. So those are other factors that also go into it. So different shuls have different policies. When our shul started, we used to have the lights on a timer, and one year there was a blackout, and then the blackout for a couple of hours, so it throws the timer switch off. And the problem was the blackout was 2 days before Yom Kippur, and nobody realized to reset it. So Shachris was pretty dark, and about halfway through Shachris, the lights went on. So at that point, we decided we're going to really splurge in the shul, and we stopped the timer, and we just leave the lights on. And then we were told, actually, the police actually recommended that we do that. They were very happy about that, because it would have made it a little bit safer. So we put into their budget a couple extra pennies for breaking the lights.
I'm going to ask you, how do they distinguish between a fire, which lasts some length of time, and a spark? When you have a spark, it's not a sustained fire. It just comes and goes. It's transient.
Right. So we assume that a spark that's going to then eventually cause things to burn. So you drive a car,
right.
So when you start a spark, but then in the end, the gas is quote-unquote burning and is being consumed because of the system that you set up. So that's tantamount to like lighting a candle. So we assume that's the same thing, even though you're right. The spark comes and goes.
So the spark is a catalyst to cause
Right, but then once I don't know enough about the inner makings of the car engine, but there's a fascinating sefer about Ochel Shabbos, where he goes through all the intricacies. He did his research on the driving a car, and he commented that if you drive around the block, so you were probably in violation of about like 10,000 different levels. Every time you press the gas, so it starts a whole series of different interactions that take place with multiple shops. If you really want to do a car shop, that's the way to go. Driving the car, that's get the most from your out of the shop. So again, that's the same idea that you're raising, that the sparks are so. The spark that starts and then causes other things to be consumed, it's just going to be like dancing out the line of fire.
The Shabbos elevator in a hotel is not in there.
But the Shabbos elevator, right? So we assume Allah that the Shabbos elevator is set up on the floor, so it's not really doing anything.
It stops at every floor.
Right,
just because you get on.
Right.
The riding is not
right. You recommend to the person I tell people that if a person's healthy and strong, they can use the exercise a little bit. You know, it's not the most Shabbos thing, but if a person has a need for it, it'll be okay. Once we were over at a hotel for Shabbos, and my kids were a little at the time, and there was a Shabbos elevator, and they thought it was a big joke, and they were running up and down the entire Shabbos night. They were about 5 years old. Like, I explained to them, we don't do that.
What about LED?
So LEDs, we assume, is most probably not the equivalent of an incandescent bulb, so it wouldn't be that Havara issue that would be outright deraisa, but it would be subject to all the other potential problems, the position problem, the other problem involved. So according to Chazon Ish, it would be a deraisa also, but according to others, it would probably only be a derabanan. And that would be important because a lot of the sensors involve those kinds of lights.
Some of our lights.
I developed
LEDs.
Right. So a lot of the lights. Right. A lot of that stuff. Right. Incandescent bulbs are almost the
I'm part of the problem. All of my bulbs are just have their own schedules in them. I don't need timer. They just do it automatically.
You should get the shift. 21st, 22nd century.
Yeah, it's like, last
part you should be like, with spec LEDs, then would there be permissible LEDs? Which only I'm not turning it off. I'm not turning it off from scratch. But I'm only making it a little darker. And again, it's LEDs.
It's not clear. Again, you may know about this more about this than I do. But it's not clear that there aren't electric circuits that are being changed. And anytime that there's anything that's changing in terms of electricity, that in itself is a problem.
Mm-hmm. And just energizing electrons can produce photons. It's not like
lightning
just changing in the chemistry.
It's
literally just injecting energy into something that then creates light because
that's
how photons are.
Right. So that's the question: is that molded? Is that a davar chadash? That would probably still be part of our original discussion. So, I don't know that. Okay, I'll leave it at that. Okay.